So this is the solution to question 4 from the advanced homework for Unit 7. A little bit of analytics to get a qualitative picture of what's going on with the Lotka-Volterra equations. So here are the equations, familiar by now, I hope, and I've written them in this factored form. That's will be a little bit more useful for us. And in a previous problem, we found a fixed point for this. We find a fixed point by looking for R and F values that make both derivatives equal to zero. If both derivatives are zero, then we have a fixed point. So one fixed point is if R and F are both zero. And that's not very interesting biologically or mathematically. It just says if there are no rabbits and foxes, there will remain no rabbits and foxes in this model. The other solution, the other equilibrium, is a little more interesting, and that's would be obtained if we solved, if we set the term in parentheses, each of these terms in parentheses equal to zero. So if we did that, we can see that F equals 4 solves this, and R equals 3 solves that. So let me just write that we have fixed point, and that's at R equals 3. F equals 4. R equals 3, F equals 4. And let's see. Let's put that on the phase plane. Here are the rabbits. Here we have foxes. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3, 4. So I will draw that on, I don't know, the red dot. Okay. So now I've set the stage for to think about what are called null clines. So let's imagine that we only have this condition met. In other words, that F is 4, but R is not necessarily 3. So if F is 4, then dr dt equals 0. And this would be called a null cline. So if we're at a null cline, this null cline is dr dt equals 0, and that's at f equals 4. So f equals 4, that's a line here. I'll draw it like this. So this is dr dt equals 0. So here, solution curves must be going straight up or straight down because they can't go side to side. The rabbit population is constant. So the solutions have to either go up or down. And let's look at the other null cline. That would happen if we made this term in parentheses zero equal to zero, and we didn't worry about this. So that would be if R equals 3. Let's see, I'll write that here. If R equals 3, then df dt equals 0. So this is another null cline. And R equals 3 on this plot is a vertical line like this. So let's look at what's going on in each quadrant. So first, let's look at this term again. If F is greater than 4, then the term in parentheses is negative, which means dr dt is negative. So let me write that down. If F is greater than 4, dr dt is negative. So F is greater than 4 above this line, and it's less than 4 below. So in this quadrant and this quadrant, dr dt is less than 0. So dr dt less than 0, dr dt less than 0. Down here, dr dt is positive. So a positive dr dt means the rabbits are increasing. A negative dr dt means the rabbits are decreasing. And this just says if they're more than 4 units of foxes, 4 tons, or whatever we decided we're measuring foxes in, then the rabbit population will decrease. If there are less than 4 tons of foxes in this little universe, then the rabbit population will increase. Increasing rabbits is motion in this direction. Decreasing rabbits is motion in that direction. All right, so now let's look at what this tells us. So this tells me that if R is less than 3, then df dt, let's see, if r is less than 3, df dt will be negative. Let me write that down. If r is less than 3, df dt is less than 0. Okay, so if r is less than 3, that means I'm to the left of this line, this nulk line, then df dt is 0. Okay, so let me write that. Let's see, df dt, sorry, is less than 0. And df dt will be positive. Oops, uh-oh, hang on. This, oh dear. I knew I was going to make a mess of this. All right. Df, when I'm to the left of this line, df dt is less than 0. If r is less than 3, that means I'm over here. This is less than 0. So df dt is less than 0. Here, df dt is greater than 0. Okay, so let me summarize this, and then we'll start drawing some arrows. So this analysis says that as far as the foxes are concerned, if I'm to the left of this, so I'm somewhere over here, the fox population will decrease. And if I'm over here, the fox population will increase. Then looking at things from the point of view of the rabbits, this says if I'm above this line, there are more than 4 tons or 4 units of foxes, the rabbit population decreases. If I'm below this line, the rabbit population increases. All right, so if I'm over here, R is increasing, F is increasing. That means motion is going to be in this direction, right? In the direction of increasing R and increasing F. If I'm over here, the rabbits are decreasing, but the foxes are still increasing. So a fox increase, that's up. Rabbit decreases to the left. So I'll move like this. Here, both rabbits and foxes are decreasing. And here, foxes are decreasing, rabbits are increasing. Rabbits increasing means I'm moving to the right. Foxes decreasing means I'm moving down. Okay, so this gives us a picture, a sense that we're going to expect some sort of cyclic behavior. These blue lines are called nulk lines. They're a line. They don't always have to be vertical. They could even be curves for more complicated differential equations where one of the derivatives is 0. So along this nulk line, I've got motion in this direction, right? Because along this nulk line, the fox increase is 0. Along this nulk line, the rabbit increase is 0. That means I'm going either straight up or straight down. So one way to analyze differential equations, a couple differential equations like this in two-dimensional space, Of course, you can do Newton's method to plot solutions, but one can also solve for these null clines, and then you can draw arrows along the null clines, and then in different regions, you can figure out which direction the general flow is, and then you can also solve for fixed points, and that gives you a general picture of how the equation behaves. This sort of analysis is beyond the scope of this course. Obviously, it makes use of a bit more algebra and calculus than we normally use. But it's a very standard topic. You can find a chapter on this in most modern or dynamical systems-y books on differential equations. So that's a little bit of analytical analysis for the Luck-Volterra equations. One can do more and analyze the nature of this fixed point. That requires a little bit of linear algebra, and so is more advanced still. But the main point of all this is hopefully not to get lost in too many details, but just to point out that there are some analytics one can do to get a general picture of solutions in a phase plane, even if you can't solve in closed form for what those curves might look like.